Welcome to the Tourism and Hospitality Management panel. My name is Allison Nash, and I will be your moderator for the duration of today's session. This morning, we have exciting guests here to speak to you about the exciting and expanding world of tourism and hospitality management. But before we begin, we have to go over a few housekeeping rules. So in case of an emergency, please exit through the nearest fire exit. Please turn off your cell phones for the duration of today's program. We ask that you remain seated for the duration of the program as well. It's only an hour and 15 minutes. It's not a huge time commitment to sit in your seat. And if you have any questions you'd like to ask the panelists, we please ask that you leave any questions until the end of the panel, as we will have a Q&A period. And finally, as many of you know, this event is Learning Passport eligible. In order to keep things as efficient as possible, we ask you to have your survey and your information page in your Learning Passport booklet filled out before you come up to get your stamp. So we will be stamping at the end of the panel. There will be stamps at the top of the stairs where Paulette is right now, as well as over there, as well as if you'd like to talk to any of our panelists at the end, please feel free to come up on the stage. So that takes care of all of that. So we're gonna get into the panel now. So the first question is, please introduce yourself and tell us about your company.
Hi there, my name's Angela Muse, and I graduated from the Mount actually in 2013, so very recently I was sitting in your folks' seat. And I now work for Ambassadors Gray Line and Murphy's The Cable Wharf, which some of you may be familiar with, maybe not. If you've been around the Halifax waterfront, you may have seen some of our boats, maybe the Harbor Hopper, Tall Ship Silva. If any of that is ringing a bell to you, that's the company that I work for. We employ anywhere from 50 to 600 people over the course of the year, just depending on the tourism season. And peak season, 600 people, we've got a lot going on. And we do lots of different types of excursions, we do different types of tours, we service all of the cruise ships that come into Halifax for different types of tours for that demographic of people that are coming in. Imports not just in Halifax, but in Sydney, Charlottetown, and St. John, New Brunswick as well. So that's land tours and water tours, because we do have 11 boats. We have buses of all different sizes. We have British double-deckers. Like I said, 11 boats and 5 gift shops. We also have Murphy's Restaurant, which seats up to 400 people. So we've got a lot of different things going on, mostly in the summer.
Hi everyone, my name is Tina Lessig, and I'm the founder of Pineapple Eventworks. Pineapple Eventworks is a new company which was founded in September 2016. So we offer a number of different event services, but we specialize in event staffing. So we have a list of professional servers and bartenders who we hire to work for our clients. Our clients to date have been everyone from hotels, caterers, event planners, people having a party at home that would like some help with the setup or the service of their party, folks having a wedding on their property that need some help with servers and bartenders. In addition to that, that's our primary focus service, but we also offer day of coordination services. So if some of you may not know what that is, it's typically seen in the wedding industry. So essentially, we meet with the bride and groom the months prior to their wedding, and we really try to understand their vision of how the day is gonna go. So basically then we're there the duration of the day, and we oversee everything from the ceremony to the cocktail hour through the dinner service, right until the dance. We're there basically to look at, take care of any last minute touches, if there are vendors delivering items to the venue, and the bride and groom are of course busy getting married and taking their pictures. They can't coordinate those details, so we're there to look after that stuff for them, basically also there to troubleshoot any unforeseen situations which happen in the event industry, and basically we're their right hand for the day.
Hi, my name is Christine Kovacevic, and I'm the manager of interpretation and visitor experience at the Canadian Museum of Immigration at Pier 21. So we're a national museum just down on the waterfront, and we talk about the history of immigration to Canada. The building used to be an old immigration shed between 1928 and 1971, so over a million people came through the building that I work in to start a new life in Canada. And so we honor that history, and we share that history with our visitors. So in my role as the manager of interpretation and visitor experience, I manage the frontline staff. So we have, right now we probably have about 13 heritage interpreters, and in the summer that will go up to maybe about 20 heritage interpreters. And so these are people that will greet visitors as they come in the museum, sell tickets, deliver any special programming that we may do, give guided tours, and basically just make sure that the visitors are having a really, really great time at the museum.
Hi everyone, I'm Helene Moberg. I'm Vice President of Sales with Destination Halifax. Destination Halifax is a destination marketing organization, or as we call it, a DMO, and sometimes referred to as a Convention and Visitor Bureau, or a CVB. So our primary responsibility is to promote Halifax both for leisure, as in tourism, and for meetings and conventions. And I oversee the sales division. There are seven of us. And again, our primary role is to promote Halifax for meetings and conventions and group sales.
Hi everyone, my name is Erin Surratt. I'm the area sales manager for the Prince George Hotel, the Cambridge Suites Hotel in Halifax, and the Cambridge Suites Hotel in Sydney. So in my role, well, I guess the company I work for, in terms of the hotels, the Prince George Hotel is a full-service, four-diamond hotel in downtown Halifax. We also have the Cambridge Suites Hotel, which is an all-suite property in Halifax and very similar property in Sydney as well. So we host meetings and events and weddings and all those sorts of things. And we just have travelers coming in, of course, from all over the world every day. In my role, I look after managing accounts that come into the hotel. So signing up new business for people that are having meetings or conventions, booking their meetings and conventions, and also setting up preferred rates for companies that visit Halifax or Sydney regularly.
Perfect. So how did you reach the position you're in now?
So I've worked in hospitality since I was about 15 years old. So I'd say that about everything I've done to date, career or job-wise, has helped me get to where I am today. I've done everything from being the hostess to being the server, worked in telemarketing. I was the baker, the grocery clerk, the ice cream scooper. I worked as a closing cashier for the Rainforest Cafe, which is a large 400-seat restaurant. I've been the manager, the teacher, and now the entrepreneur. I also grew up in a family business. My parents have been operating a home-based business for over 35 years. More specifically, I recently left a 10-year tenure working for Holland College's Culinary Institute of Canada. I started there as the dining room server right after I graduated from the hotel and restaurant management program. That turned into being the dining room technician, which was basically teaching other hotel restaurant management students on the job training in the training restaurant. From there, I went into teaching bartending. I also assisted the dining room manager. And for the last 6 years of the tenure, I was the first banquet and catering coordinator. So as a coordinator, I did client relations, the sales, I looked after producing all the contracts, looking after inventory and ordering, including the bar service, and I managed a team of roughly 15 staff who I also hired and trained, and we worked daily closely with the students. So basically, I was there to see the event through from the booking process right to the management of the event, the day of the event. So it was during my time at the college where I coordinated over approximately 500 different events. I would receive calls often from caterers or the general public looking for help. They wanted us to send students out to help cook their food for their parties, as well as look after service and bartending. So that wasn't necessarily something we could do for liability reasons, plus you couldn't offer the opportunity to one student and not all students. So I found myself coordinating the staff who I hired to work our banquet department to go work those events if it didn't conflict with our own banquet schedule. So after getting so many of these calls, I realized there was a need for a service that doesn't exist in Atlantic Canada. So I decided to leave Holland College and move to Halifax to pursue this business idea so that I could target a bigger market. I'm almost done. I joined this self-employed benefits program through SEED. So I moved here about a year ago, and here I am now.
So I've been working in the tourism-ish industry since I was probably about the same age, since about 15. In different museums, volunteering in different museums. So I went to University of Ottawa and I did my undergrad in history. And after that, I knew that I wanted to keep going in that world of history. I found it fascinating. But what I really found fascinating was how people interacted with history. How do we talk about history and how do people absorb history? And how do I make it really interesting for people? Because I knew that that was a topic that a lot of people find really boring. And I didn't feel that way. So I wanted to share that with people. So I knew pretty early on that I wanted to work at a museum in any capacity. So then I did my Applied Museum Studies degree from Algonquin College in Ontario. And then I moved back to Halifax. I'm originally from Halifax. So I moved back and I was kind of, looking around at what museums there were and where I might want to work. And I heard that this little private museum, Pier 21, was going to become a federal museum very soon. And I knew that that meant something pretty exciting. That meant that that museum would start to get government funding. So I waited for a position. I applied to be a volunteer, which was a big, that was an important point in getting the job. And then when a position came up, I applied and I went into the interview with, literally, I went into the interview with a box of things I had done. I just put everything that I had done over the years through school, working at all the different museums I had done. I walked into the interview and gave them a box of my work. And that really, really impressed them. They liked my box of experience and they ended up hiring me. So it went really well. So.
And you're still there.
And I'm still there. Yeah, they kept me. So that was, about 7 years ago. And through those 7 years, we've become a federal museum. We did major renovations. We've changed from being a tiny nonprofit organization where I had to bring my own pencils and paper to work the first couple months because their budget was so little, to now being a federal museum with a solid base of funding that we can grow from. So it's been a very exciting ride.
I probably shouldn't even admit this, but I've been in the tourism industry for 39 years. I'm originally from Sweden, so I started worked at two hotels in Stockholm. Started off working in the front desk, and then moved. I lived in Canada for a bit, so moved back to Canada and started working in sales. So it was starting off at a hotel sales level, and then I ended up working for Hilton International doing national sales. And from there, I was director of sales at the Metro Toronto Convention Center. And my husband and I both really wanted to live in Halifax. So I applied for the job with Destination Halifax, and I've been here for 10 years now, and I love it. Thank you.
So I graduated from the Mount in 2003, and I actually I started out at St. Mary's University, and it came time to pick my major, and I did not know what to do. So I was looking into other opportunities and found out about this tourism program I knew nothing about, and because I had recently been on a trip to Mexico, and I was just like, man, this hotel business, this would be so fun. Oh, wow, there's actually a degree you can get in this. This is fantastic. So I went ahead and moved all my credits over and started here. January 99. And anyhow, so with that, of course, I did the co-op program. So with the co-op program, I started my sort of tourism journey. So I worked for Halifax Tourism as their visitor at the Visitor Information Center in Bedford, which is no longer. And then I worked as the cruise ship terminals, what we called at the time, which is where Pier 21 is, sort of where the Seaport Farmers Market is. So when the cruise ships would come in, we had a little booth that we would set up and take down pretty much every day to welcome the cruise ships when they came in, and that was really fun. You know, lots of people from New York and Germany and all over the world, and we would just help them out, telling them, very similar to my role previously, where to go, what things to do in Halifax. And from there, I took my third co-op right away, and I went to Disney World. So I worked for a year in Disney. I worked at Epcot as a cultural representative and talked all things Canada and looked like a lumberjack and all that kind of stuff. So it was a really, really fun experience, and I worked with people from all over the world. You're housed with people from all over the world where you work there and where they put you up. And from there, I came back to finish my degree. But I needed a job to kind of finish off, because I'd kind of done almost all my co-ops sort of in a row, so I still had about a year and a half of school to finish up. So I actually applied at the Westin Hotel. They were looking for a concierge. And in the concierge role at the Westin Hotel, it's a suited position where you're basically doing the same thing, giving directions, helping people get dinner reservations, theater reservations, that sort of thing. So it was a really great fit for me to dive into hotel world, because I had done all of that in terms of being really familiar with the city and what's going on and what to do and where to go. So I went ahead and did that. They cross-trained me on the front desk, so I got that experience as well. And then an opportunity came up to fill in a maternity leave for literally 6 weeks. It was all that was left of it, at the Ramada Hotel in Dartmouth, which is now closed for renovation to become a new hotel. And 6 weeks after the interview turned into 6 months, and then turned into 3 years. So I went there as a sales administrator, and I had just graduated university at that point, so it was a great job to go into, and then eventually became their meetings and conference coordinator, eventually became their sales manager. And then I got the opportunity to come to the Prince George Hotel, and I have been with this company, with these sort of group of hotels, for over 10 years now.
I'm Saran from obviously technical difficulties here. I'm Saran from Studio East Restaurant. I'm originally from Toronto. I never imagined being here in the food industry. My mom has always told me never to. My family are farmers, and really we work with our hands, and my parents have always envisioned me of working in the office or some sort of like high-ranking positions, because we came here for a reason. And of course, nope, I didn't choose that. Although I studied business, marketing, and graphic communications, I also worked with TD Bank for a very long time as a scholarship student at the bank. So it gave me a lot of like marketing and financial things that I needed. And my company, how I got here, is food. Like, I love food, I love to eat. Anybody asked me, why are you doing food? I said, I love food, I love to eat, I love to cook, and very self-taught, you know, learn, absorb, you know, sort of everything kind of person. So I love to learn, and so our company is in Studio East. It's a restaurant neighborhood in North End, if you haven't been there yet. We do Asian fusion, ethnic food. Sustainability is a big thing for us. And before that, I was doing farmers market. I was having my own kiosk at Seaport Market in Halifax and different parts of Nova Scotia. Then moved across the world and explore food, and ended up in Calgary, Vancouver, and doing food again, having my own. So I've been known as a cucumber girl to farmers market chef, and now here I am. So food has brought me here, and there's a lot of opportunities here in Nova Scotia right now, and I want you guys to stay here, because so much happening, so much opportunities for young students like yourself who are going into this into this hospitality and tourism industry. So it's a lot of great things happening.
Sure. So I started doing co-op at the Mount. I did 3 different work terms in very different parts of the tourism industry in Halifax. I started out working at Spirit Spa, did my first co-op position there as a guest services coordinator. My next position was with the Halliburton, which is a really cute little boutique hotel in downtown Halifax. Had an amazing work term with them as well. I really thought that, and I still do think, that hotels are probably where I'm going to end up someday because I love the hotel industry. But for my 3rd work term, I decided to do something completely outside my comfort zone, and I applied to be a Harbor Hopper tour guide, which was terrifying, and I shed many tears about giving my first tour, shed some before my first tour, after my first tour, but then I was fine. I was good after that. But that was actually my first introduction to the company that I'm working for now. So that was with Murphy's on the Water before Murphy's and Ambassadors became one very large tour operator together. So after I was a Harbor Hopper tour guide for a summer, I did it again the next summer because it was the best summer job ever. Got to meet a ton of people, got to know Halifax really well, and just had a blast doing it generally. But it was a seasonal position, so I needed something a little bit different to actually stay employed through the entire year once I graduated from here in 2013. So after that, I went back to the spa industry because it was the right opportunity came up. I met the right people, and I ended up managing Remedy Spa for 2 years, which is still one of my favorite little holes in the wall in Halifax. It's a great, great little spot. And one day, our mutual connection, Kevin Burgess, who I graduated from the Mount with, we took many classes together. He had just come back from traveling, and we decided to sit down and have lunch one day, and he said, "I think I've got a job for you." And lo and behold, it was a job with Ambassadors selling charter buses, and I have been with the company ever since. So really, how did I reach the position I'm in now? It was through my connections from the Mount, really, and also my co-op experience, because I kind of had a bit of familiarity with the industry to begin with. So not only Kevin, he was a connection for my job now, but also I met my boss now, Sean Buckland. He's the director of sales at Ambassadors. I met him at the Mount, and I met our COO, Mary Dempster, because she came in and did a panel just like this, and we chatted after one of the panels. So I got to know quite a few people that I'm now working for because of the Mount. So I've been in my position now for going on 2 years in lots of different ways. I've done different jobs actually with Ambassadors. I sold charter buses for about 9 months, and then I moved down to Murphy's and sold weddings and did some event management down there. And actually 2 weeks ago, I started a new job back with Ambassadors, doing a little bit of HR work, as well as my title is HR and Charter Administrator. It covers a lot of different things. But I'm doing a bit of data analysis and sales forecasting, and doing a bit of support for both the HR and sales departments. So I'm getting to know a completely different side of the company, which is what is really exciting to me. I've kind of gotten to know Murphy's and Ambassadors from a sales perspective, and now I'm doing more internal work, which is really cool.
What keeps you going to work every day? Give us an example of an event that really made your day.
Well, I don't think I'd be good at my job if I didn't love people. So I love talking to people. I love listening to people. I love interacting with my team of interpreters, but I love interacting with visitors as well. So for me, it's kind of making a little bit of a difference in the day for somebody. I work in a place, I'm really fortunate to work in a place that already has a pretty strong emotional pull. A lot of our visitors come to the museum because they have family that came through Pier 21. You know, their grandmother took her very first steps in Canada right there on our floors. So that, you know, the person's coming into the museum already, you know, emotionally charged. And I get to be with them and show them this piece of their family history and cry with them as we kind of explore that history together. I love that I go to work every day, not, you know, I mean, I know what I'm going to do. I have certain duties that I have to do every day, but I really kind of go in with something different. I'm the type of person that if I went into work every day and did the same thing, I think I'd go a little crazy. So it's always different. A lot of problem solving. Right before leaving to come here, the museum, the film that we show, just decided to stop working all of a sudden. So we were kind of, okay, how do we solve this problem? So we had to restart the museum, and it was good. It was fine. It worked out great, but I like that problem solving. I really like it when things come up and you have to react to it. I also, something I love about my work too is that I've tried to make our museum as open to feedback as possible. We have lots of places where people can express how they feel about our museum, and we take all of that information and really try to react to it. And so I really love that feeling of getting better and better every day based on what people are telling us they want. So that's really lovely. A specific example of something that made my day, I think when I first started working at the museum, I knew it was an important place, but I hadn't really realized it, I hadn't felt it yet. And so I was just walking through the museum, just checking to make sure everything was clean and in order. And there was this woman who was touching one of the doors. So these are the original wooden doors leading from the area that that we call the gateway, where people would have physically come into the building from the ships. And so she was there and she was just touching the wooden doors and crying, like tears streaming down her face. And I was thinking, oh, what happened? Like, did she hurt herself? Did she get her finger caught in the door? What's happening? And so when I went over and I said, well, can I help you with anything? And she just opened up to me and she told me about how, you know, her mother had come through Pier 21, but her mother unfortunately passed away right after giving birth to her. And so she never knew her mother, but that her mom had been right here and walked through these doors. And she was just, you know, kind of being there with her. And I think that's when I was like, I work at a really important place. I never really realized it before. And that in that moment, I really made a connection with this person that I had no idea who she was, you know, 2 minutes earlier. And then suddenly here we are crying together, talking about her mother. And so that's what I love about this industry is that there's the potential to make meaningful connections with other people. That's why I do it. That's why I get up every day.
Okay, that's a tough act to follow. mine, as far as you know, what keeps me motivated and what do I love about what I do on a daily basis is very similar in that it's about relationships. It's about relationships with my colleagues, with my industry partners, so with Pier 21, Prince George, ambassadors, it's our overall industry, I think. And most people in this industry are very passionate about what they do. It's also a really fun industry, and you know, every day is different. Like I'm the same way. I can plan my day, but I walk in the door and it just goes like this. So. I also think if there was a piece of advice that I would give, it's that you really have to go with the flow because you can't plan everything out. My favorite event is not quite as emotional, but I was part of the host committee for the Canadian Country Music Association, and they held Country Music Week here in September of 2015. So from the bid process through to when they actually were here was about 4 years, and it took a lot of planning, and it was just so amazing to me to see people across Canada, but really around the world, all gathering here for a specific country event, but just to see the pride of all the Haligonians coming together and just, you know, I think having lived in various spots around the world that I don't think I've ever seen a place like Halifax that is just so proud of coming from, or being from here?
So for me, again, similar in terms of the fact that I just love working with people. I love talking to people, learning, just meeting anyone. So learning about new companies, you know, we may get a call come in and it's from an organization that is just looking to have a meeting, and I, you know, look it up online, research it. Oh, wow, I haven't heard about them before. Every day is different. There's always new companies, new things happening. And that's what I love. So I really enjoy connecting with people and learning about new organizations, what's coming to Halifax. I love the city, so it's something I definitely feel very proud of. And then in terms of just, yeah, having a great team to back you, having a great product behind you that you can represent and feel proud of, definitely, you know, keeps me coming back every day. And then in terms of just work, like for myself, I have 3 young children, so my work has been really great with sort of a work-life balance. I have a very busy job, but I actually do I work 4 days of the 5-day business week. That helps me sort of manage my home life with my career life, and it works for me, and so that's really great. That keeps me there. That's definitely an anchor for sure. But in terms of the passion for the industry, I think it's just meeting people and helping people. And while I can't really think of a specific event, that's really what it is just knowing that you've helped someone, even in any little way, just gotten back to them quickly. Oh, thanks so much, Erin. Oh, Grace, you saved my life. You know, thanks for fixing that for me. That's as easy as, okay, job well done. I can go home today and feel good about my day. So getting that is great.
What keeps me coming to work every day is I'm my own boss. I can do whatever I want. It's not as easy as you think it is. How many of you want to be your own boss one day? Okay, well, good. It's harder than you think it is. Sometimes I think, oh my God, why don't I just work for somebody? You know, being your own boss is definitely a motivation, because you have a lot of control and you can really mold and shape experience of people's lives, you know, in terms of, you know, what they eat, the quality of food, the product you put out, the service, building a team that's delivering a memorable and creating a culture that is very, you know, enhances the diversity that we're, you know, that we're in. I think it's wonderful. Those are the things that makes me really happy. And being able to do a lot of things, you know, if you're your own boss, you can do different things. And I love the food, working with food, and being able to kind of develop a menu and taste it and experiment and try with everybody, you know, have a guest at the bar and be like, hey, I'm making this. Do you want to try and see what you think? And get people really excited about food and coming up with something that is still comforting, but still very creative and just kind of refreshing, and makes our guests look forward to coming over and over again. It's like this, creating this addiction. It's overall creating every overall experience of having the right, having great staff and product and an atmosphere that they want to come over and over without even thinking it. So creating top of mind positioning for my brand is very exciting. The one thing that makes me really happy, people say, and I believe this, and they say something like, oh, it's so good. You know, when someone tells you that, you know, and you ask them, you know, it feels good to get that really positive feedback, and to hear them, it's from guests from table to table, when you're touching tables, you're having that relationship with them and knowing what they like, but also knowing that they're really enjoying the product that you're putting out. It's very, it makes my day, and seeing those faces and then having them bring their families over and their friends and them tweeting about it, and putting posts on Instagram and Twitter, and they're really, you know, positive feedback, and that really is making a difference in people's life, whether you know it or not. You know, in the hospitality and tourism industry, it's a big part of what we do. We eat three times a day or more, you know, and it's a way of socializing, a way of connecting. And so that's always really, for me, it touches me to the core when food can connect people, when food can break boundaries and create conversations and find a way to how do we collaboratively live more sustainably and better. And having this, you know, just food has so much connection to everything. It's, you know, when food breaks down, you know, family breaks down, there's a lot of linking thing to it. So that's makes me feel like when I'm doing something like being in the restaurant industry and doing the best that we can be is making a difference, you know, and creating quality of life, creating balance for myself and for others, being responsible for, you know, for people who are coming out of school, and how do we mentor new apprenticeships. We've got a lot of people coming in wanting to learn, and that's great, and that's willingness to share everything, willingness to, it's exciting when you have someone who wants to be a part of it and want to learn everything and help embrace and grow this industry, make it better and stronger. So that what keeps me going, for sure.
So for me, the thing that keeps me going to work every day and loving my job every day is the fact that no 2 days are ever the same. There's always something different going on and something new, a new challenge to figure out. Even just working on the Halifax waterfront, the Murphy's main office is right on the boardwalk. You're surrounded by everything that's going on in downtown Halifax, and there's so much going on, so many people visiting, so many people exploring the city, and being part of a tour operator gives you a really good front lines opportunity to chat with people and to figure out what's brought them to Halifax or why they've come back 10 years running and why they keep going on that same cruise that brings them to Halifax. And that's I find that really inspiring, and I love to be part of, to be right in the center of our city. And not just Halifax, but Nova Scotia too. There's, it's a really quite an amazing industry to work in. I think we would all agree. There's so many different events happening, conferences, the food seems amazing. Being part of the transportation industry, we carry all of the, not all of them, but quite a large number of the university varsity teams, so we're right in the middle of CIS basketball right now. We get drivers who are calling me, drivers like bus drivers calling to check in on their teams and see how they're doing when they're traveling to Victoria for finals. Like people just get really passionate about what's going on, and it's really cool to be part of that. I never thought that I would work in the motor coach industry. That's not something that ever crossed my mind, but now that I'm in it, it's really cool to be a part of it. And I don't really have a very specific example of an event that really made my day, but the first thing that came to mind when I was thinking about this was just the fact that walking to my office any given Tuesday in the middle of the summer, there could be a huge tall ship towering over my office and like sailors from Colombia, and like there, it's really cool. Like you never know what your day is going to look like when you walk to work, which is really neat.
So I'm really driven by the desire to help people and problem solve. Throughout my journey working in the food and beverage and event industry, I discovered that that's a talent that I possess, is problem solving. In addition to that, I like the idea of generating or creating jobs for both myself as well as other people. And at this point, early stage in my business, I stay motivated because I have so much still to figure out. I still have a lot of policies and procedures to put in place. And like some of the other panelists, when you work for yourself, you fill every role. So you are the HR and payroll, you are the salesperson. You look after recruitment, you do marketing and social media. I'm the event manager, sometimes the server or the bartender. I I'm the bookkeeper. So it's easy to stay motivated when you have lots to do. I work in events, so it's hard to pick one specific event. You know, weddings are close to home for me because I like that industry. I've also been involved in 2 royal visits, which was really exciting. Fall flavor events, which are held in PEI, they bring celebrity chefs to the province to host interactive type of events. So I had a chance to meet, if any of you are foodies, Chef Chuck Hughes, Chef Rob McEwen, Chef Michael Smith, Chef Lynn Crawford, Chef Bob Bloomer, Susser Lee, just to scratch the surface, Anna Olson. But the event that stands out the most in my mind would have to be a wedding that took place the year of Hurricane Arthur. If any of you remember that, it was a few summers ago. It was the same weekend as the Cavendish Beach Country Music Festival, which Blake Shelton was supposed to play, but he couldn't land. Their plane couldn't land because the weather was so ridiculous. So we had an event. We had a wedding booked at the college that night. So weddings don't really get rescheduled. They go on no matter what's happening. So we, you know, the day had to go on. Of course, the college didn't have power. So we went, I met the bride and groom at the facility. They had their ceremony. It was a small ceremony, which was held in a private room. That was fine. Power still wasn't back. Luckily for us, this was more of an appetizer food station type of meal service as opposed to a sit-down plated dinner, which would have been a little bit tougher to pull off without power. So we had to modify the menu a little bit because when you don't have power, the hood fans don't work in the kitchen, which can be dangerous. So, you know, the party went on. We served the food that we could. The bar was slinging drinks as much as they would have had they had power. I kind of thought the attendance might not be as great, but everybody showed up with their party shoes on. So come sunset, we actually lit little votive candles, and if you've ever been to the Culinary Institute, the room overlooks the water, and there are 3 of the 4 walls are windows, so it's very pretty to begin with. But without power and candles lit around the perimeter of the room, we had candles going down the main staircase, in the bathrooms, we basically worked the rest of the evening by candlelight, and people had a great time. They thought it was so romantic. The bride and groom were just ecstatic with how everything ended up turning out. I even had collaborated with the DJ. He ended up finding a small generator so we could operate their slideshow. They had a big slideshow they wanted to show guests. So we had a slideshow and a microphone without power, and then around 10 o'clock, the power came back. So it was just exciting how everybody came together to make this wedding happen, even though we didn't have power and there was a hurricane happening outside.
How does your education help in your current position?
As I said earlier, my university education is 100 years ago. So. I've learned a lot since, and I think if there's one thing that I would say about education is that it's really a process. So it's all about learning throughout your entire career. It doesn't stop here. And for me, I've been very lucky in that I've attended a lot of conferences with an education component to it. And I'm continually trying to learn through, you know, whether it's webinars or educational sessions. I think you'll learn a lot as well through networking. And I would just say that don't walk out the door and say, that's the end of my education, because it really will continue throughout your career.
So for myself, I graduated from this university in 2003 with my Tourism and Hospitality Management bachelor's degree, and I think it served me pretty well. I certainly think it shows a dedication to the industry when you're going to spend 4 years of your time and money on an industry and focusing on that. So certainly, I think if you're flipping through resumes, it might stand out a little bit when you're applying for for a hotel job or something in the tourism destination management type of role. I certainly think it made a difference in me sort of moving into roles and moving up in roles fairly quickly at a young age. Like I said, just showing that dedication to know that I was sort of in it for the long haul. And then I never discount my co-op experience. I think that was so great, and I still talk about Disney like all the time. Seems it's definitely an icebreaker in interviews and things like that for sure. So it was, I'm just so pleased to have done the program here, and I certainly think it helped me.
Education. Stay in school. I hated school. I was more of a really hands-on, like, give me what you need me to, like, just throw it at me kind of person, because I don't learn by sitting in lectures, and I know how bored you might be sitting there and thinking on what to do next and blah, blah, blah. But education, one thing, has helped me. I did a lot of different things, actually. I didn't stay in one area. I was an assistant bookkeeper, and I was 13 years old because I really wanted to work in an office. That idea of being in an office and in front of the computer, this is a long time ago. I'm much older than you think I am. But so I had a knowledge of how to, you know, do bookkeeping when I was 13 years old, and then I went on doing a lot of teaching, mentoring, community work, you know, in the clinics and doing events for the community. So to me, that was education. I spent a lot of time going to school and doing extracurricular activities to really, you know, just, I was just one of those people who just loved being busy, working and then doing. So I think outside of education is very important to do those extracurricular activities. You don't learn everything in class, but you do develop that discipline, and I've gotten that from school, is the discipline and the basic principle and foundation of concepts and theories, and it has been useful. Like, for an example, math. I hated math. I had to get a good grade to go to university for math, so I ended up acing it. Couldn't do calculus, though, or finite. I hated, I just didn't, wasn't really good in math, but I was able to use a lot of the math that I've learned to in school, to university, and carried that on, you know, figuring out all kinds of, in graphic world, and it's just crazy. But definitely, even if you're not good in math, even though you don't ace your classes, you know, your attitude really, is going to take what you learn, every single thing, and transform it into your everyday life experiences. No matter how small, how big something is, it's great. Like, you're gonna learn, you're gonna be able to put so much into different things. Like, oh yeah, I learned that. Oh yeah, I did that. You know, sometimes it seems useless. Like, what is these spreadsheets, and why am I doing this? And, you know, but you'll be amazed when you get out there. If you're not already working, and if you're working, you're probably kind of, you know, getting your feet wet. But once, you know, into 4 or 5 years into working in any areas, you know, whether you end up going into the same field that you study, you're going to take everything that you've learned and be able to apply. But the discipline is huge, and that's what has helped me with education, is discipline. Coming to class on time, doing my homework, and you know, just applying what I've learned to outside. I have used every single thing possible, from even cleaning the garbage. Like, you know, there's a lot of thing that seems useless, but there's nothing. Everything you've learned, everything you're hearing, is so valuable. It's something that you can put into something. So never find something that you don't enjoy useless, because definitely math wasn't my strength, and I'm using it so much right now, and being my own boss, running my own restaurant, figuring out numbers, how do we get there? How do we, you know, how do we increase guest checks, and how do we add value and still, you know, make and increase profit margins at the same time? Like, those are all problem solving, and it's exciting because it's real world stuff, right? And you see people do it, and they're successful, and, you know, so there's a way to apply the things you've learned to, and if not, you find a team. You find someone who's really good at that and help you with it. So, yeah.
I find that my education, particularly taking the degree program here at the Mount, it helps me every single day. Because our company does do a lot of different things, taking classes like restaurant management, even though I've never worked in a restaurant specifically or really pursued that part of the industry, taking that class made it much less terrifying to jump in at Murphy's and be able to help out wherever I could, whenever I was needed, whenever we had every seat filled in the restaurant. It's a 400-person restaurant. Be able to jump in and help and have a general understanding of that part of the company, it really helps. And same with beverage management. Like, these types of classes are very practical and have been extremely useful. Accounting and stats, didn't particularly enjoy my time in those classes, but that's pretty much what I'm doing now every day. And I never thought that I would end up doing that and putting all of that knowledge into practice, but I'm finding that I'm really enjoying it. So, I mean, I am super appreciative of having to take those classes sometimes multiple times over to get through them, but it's stuck in there, so it's all good now. And co-op, I mean, without the co-op program, I wouldn't be where I am now. I wouldn't have made those connections and even skills like working at Spirit Spa, starting there, got me a management job at another spa, which really honestly has helped me. Those types of skills that I learned there were really useful managing 400 plus tour bus arrivals at Murphy's for the summer. So just everything you learn from every class, it'll probably surprise you how useful it is, but it's pretty neat.
So I have a diploma in hotel and restaurant management, which I completed at Holland College, but actually did my first year of the program at Niagara College. So I transferred my credits from Niagara to Holland College, and in order to complete the two-year program in 1 year at Holland College, it meant I had some double, well, not a double workload, but more courses at the same time as anyone else I was studying with. So that really just taught me to persevere and push forward when I got tired of tests and projects and assignments. I just kept pushing through. I also did some university courses in adult education, so that's helped me today to understand the adult learner and how they learn and how to teach and train them. And without my education is really the reason I am able to do what I'm doing today, in terms of I enjoy to teach how to teach or not how to teach. I enjoy teaching table etiquette, bartending, and dining room service and banquet operations. So without my education, I wouldn't be able to sit here and confidently say I can teach those things.
I'm very thankful for my education. First of all, I think it got me in the interview room. So right on my resume, I think if I didn't have that on my resume, they wouldn't have called me, frankly. At that time at the museum, when we were littler, when we had a smaller budget, we didn't have anyone working at the museum that really had a background in museums yet. It was something that had just kind of organically grown, and we had administrators, but nobody with a museum background. So when I was able to put that on my resume, that was very attractive to them. I'm also thankful for my education because it really showed me what I didn't want to do. I didn't go to Disney. That would have been amazing. I had a co-op placement in the third level basement of the Bank of Canada, where I sat in this basement all by myself all day for like 3 weeks making labels. And it was the moment when I started talking to the radio that I realized that I was alone and I needed people in my life. So it was actually as horrible an experience as that was. It was great because that was the moment that I was like, okay, I cannot work in a third level basement where there's no sun with no people. I really, really need people in my life. And so that made it very clear to me right away. So I'm thankful for my education because it, again, showed me what I didn't want to do in some cases. I've also, I think with my education, it's really been helpful in kind of evolving my position at the museum. So when I was first hired, I just managed the tour guides. So I just made schedules for the tour guides. I hired them. There wasn't really much training, and they gave their guided tours, and that was it. But because I kind of came with a little bit more confidence to the position, and I came with this great foundation of knowledge, I could tell my boss that, you know, I think that this job needs to be bigger. I think I need to do more than just that. I think I need to, you know, start managing a little bit more of the sales because nobody was really doing that at the time. I need to, you know, establish more of a training session. And she was like, yeah, I'll go do it. So I think kind of coming in with the education that I had gave me that push to really develop, not just develop myself, but also develop the position into something a little bit more far-reaching beyond the traditional role.
Describe some of the changes in the industry you've experienced in the last 5 years. What changes or trends do you think are going to continue moving forward?
So first thing that came to mind, and I think Helene will probably touch on this, is just that our city is definitely growing. We have a new Halifax Convention Center that'll be opening at the end of the year. With that, we will have conventions from all over the world that we have not been able to house in past because we just physically did not have the space to offer those types of events here. So it's very exciting. So that's certainly a new change. And I was trying to think of another trend I sort of noticed, and I was thinking about social media and just how it's evolved even in just the last 5 years to be more of a business tool. I mean, I think it always was, but just certainly more of sort of an acceptable business tool. It doesn't look like you're sort of slacking off at work on social media. It's all very, I mean, if your company doesn't have a Twitter account or LinkedIn and all of these sorts of things. It's all very necessary and sort of staying up and staying in people's, staying in people's faces, I suppose, in this industry. So certainly noticed a big growth in that, and I'm sure that's not slowing down anytime soon.
Changes it's constant. So I'm thinking of change that what I can tell you what would be beneficial for you to know that I've sent earlier and as you've said that we haven't seen the growth in Halifax in 50, 60 years like this. This is a time where, you know, just you're very lucky. We're always hiring. We're always looking for people. And one thing in terms of hiring trend is do pay attention to what you put on Facebook and social media because we do look at when we get a resume, that's probably the first thing we look at is, you know, we can tell, you know, if the person has a good attitude and by the way they present themselves or even seeing what you put out. So it is something that you probably know, but it is not a trend. It's becoming a norm. So that's one thing. The other thing in the industry is in terms of just thinking of you guys, there's so many changes in industry, but you know, as an entrepreneur, owning my own business, you always think about building a team. Having a team is fundamental to your business. Like that is the one thing that we really believe in is people. People makes your business. And so the one thing that we're noticing about people coming into the industry, they're new from school, is that we have to make sure we have time to take in new people. For a new restaurant, if you're thinking of going to a new restaurant, that's just open or open a year. May not, you know, we'll learn a lot because there's a lot of things, especially in a small family-owned run business like ours is you will be able to learn a lot of things, like, you know, even things that's out of the structure. It's an open box, an open solution to endless challenges. So the trend I think people are going to is they're looking for these small businesses. We're looking at a lot of students saying, I want to work for a locally owned business. That's something you were seeing, and it's great. It's fantastic. But you do also have to, we do have to also make it clear that, you know, it's not as structured as, let's say, if you're going to Moxie's. And, you know, there's a lot of benefits of working for a local business. Because it's really real. You really get that connection. You really see the problems. You really see neighbors, the neighborhood loyal guests come in, you know, 2-3 times a day, and you build that relationship. So that's one thing we're seeing as a trend, is people coming in really wanting to connect. The connection is very important for a lot of young people coming out of school. Even people who are, you know, worked for big companies, they're now wanting to work for a smaller owned company because it's just more a connection thing. So that's one of the biggest thing that I've seen, which is wonderful. I do like to mention, though, that it is good to have both. Be able to see corporate, the way it runs, to work for a corporate structured company and a local company. So you have a good balance. And, you know, that's something that is very useful, helpful, help you grow your career and being able to have, being flexible. So, yeah, it's going to be huge. There's going to be so many restaurants opening right now, and so many bars, like a lot of, the sky's the limit. We have a hard time filling a managed position for a year and 6 months now since we opened. Just find that pool of talent here is very limited in Nova Scotia. So we really look forward to attracting more people from other other provinces and to come here, because there's so much going on. You wouldn't believe it. So stay here.
I would actually echo quite a lot of that. I think that it's something that we've been hearing for quite a while, that the whole local trend, everyone's talking about supporting local and buying local and doing everything as local as possible. I see it a lot in our products that we offer at Murphy's, like the Nova Scotia Wine Cruise, Craft Beer Cruise, featuring lots of local brewers, and people are wanting to support local businesses. We have the Magic Wine Bus in the Valley, where you can go and get on a double-decker and tour a bunch of local wineries. So that's definitely a trend that seems to be still going very strong, which is awesome. Local food festivals, lots of different things there. We've also seen a lot of increase in the cruise ship arrivals in Halifax. I would estimate about 20% increase in cruise ship arrivals between all the different ports that my company services. So not just Halifax, but Charlottetown, St. John, New Brunswick, and Sydney as well. Sydney's seeing huge growth in the cruise industry. And that's not stopping anytime soon. They're going to keep, cruise ships are going to keep coming, and there's going to be even more coming next year. Another trend and change that we've seen over the past few years and moving forward as well is bus tour group arrivals, particularly the Chinese market coming from places like Toronto. There was a 31% increase with those types of groups purchasing products from my company, for example, like the Harbor Hopper coming in for lobster dinners. There was a 31% increase in arrivals last year. And so that's a trend also that I can definitely say will continue. And I mean, I haven't been in the industry for a full 5 years yet, so I look forward to seeing what else new comes up.
So I've noticed how important people look at the quality of their service. Just the same way that a bad meal or a great meal can make or break it for you, the same thing is the same thing with service. So I find that people are more, they're looking for that experience, and they're looking for quality service. They're also looking for interactive experiences. So I found working at the Culinary Institute, people want to attend culinary classes, they want to join boot camps, they want to see where their food comes from, how it's farmed, they want to be part of the process, they want to see how it's prepared and how it goes from the seed to their table. I would say, not to echo everything that others have said, so what I can see a trend moving forward, speaking to the wedding industry in particular, I think people are gonna get away from hiring wedding planners because they wanna do things themselves. DIY is huge right now. So I could see brides or grooms or couples getting married going through the event or wedding planning process themselves and then hiring day of coordinators to look after things the day that of their wedding. So that's my prediction.
So I wanted to talk about the Chinese market, so I'm happy that you brought that up, because that's something that's really exciting for us. So at our museum, we noticed that there's an increase in Chinese tourists to Halifax, but none of them were coming to our museum, not a single one. And we were wondering what we're doing wrong. They go to the other museums. Yeah, I know, I was like, we need to talk later. But on that note, and again, something I love about this job is you see a problem and you solve it. So we saw that problem and I was like, well, why don't we start offering more stuff in Mandarin? And my boss was like, yeah. And so we hired a Mandarin-speaking heritage interpreter who's developing a tour right now. We got our film translated. Yeah, yep. we got our film translated, is subtitled in Mandarin, and we have just started our online presence on different Chinese tourism websites. So in 1 week, so at the beginning of the week, we were on this one particular, and I can't remember what the website was. We started at number like 47 of things to do in Halifax on this one Chinese tourism website. But once we hired this new Chinese interpreter, she was able to beef up our profile, and now we're number 3 on this website of things to do in Halifax for Chinese visitors. So we're working on that. Cruise ships, yeah, lots. So many cruise ships coming in, so we get a lot of international visitors. In the past, the proportion was a lot more local visitors and fewer international, but that gap, it's closing. I mean, we're getting more and more international visitors all the time, especially off the cruise ships. Motor coach companies are a big deal that's getting to be bigger and bigger. I've been going to some of these big motor coach marketing events. So you go and you basically have 7 minutes to sell your product to different motor coach companies. It's kind of like speed dating, but not dating. speed working. So that was great. I totally agree with what you were saying about the interactive experience. We're seeing that a lot at our museum. Visitors, you know, in terms of museums, you can just go online and read about Pier 21 and how important it was. So we're competing with that. We're like, okay, we live in a world now where people can do visual tours or virtual tours, and people can just read about why we're important. What are we gonna do to make them come in the door and pay admission to come to our museum? So we develop these incredible experiences. You know, we have these special programs. You get to come in and step on the floor and touch these suitcases. So that's really something that I think that we're gonna see more and more and more. Visitors don't wanna come in and look at an artifact and read a panel anymore. They want to do something. And so that's something that we've had to really adapt to. Also, the importance of social media, like what you were saying, super important. Our rating on TripAdvisor is something that I'm kind of becoming a little obsessed with. I check it every day, and it hasn't moved for a really long time, so I should probably stop checking it so often. But you know, getting those digital comments, that word of mouth online is so unbelievably important now, and it wasn't that important like even like 2-3 years ago. That's something that's getting to be more important with every passing day.
So I know we're trying to wrap this up. I'll be as quick as I can. As Aaron mentioned, we do have a brand new convention center that's coming to Halifax, opening in December of 2017. And I think it's going to change a lot of things. In addition to that, we've got the new central library with amazing event space. The Discovery Center just opened up last month. and we've got a brand new hotel coming on board. You can see even the whole landscape of Halifax is changing. So that's what I see as far as the industry. The trend, and I won't talk too much about it, but the biggest trend, I think, and we've seen it coming in the last couple of years, is shared economy. So the introduction of Airbnb and Uber. And I don't see that going away. I think it will probably change tourism, and there'll be more and more companies like that that will explode really around the world.
Perfect. So we're just about out of time. If anyone would have any questions they'd like to ask the panelists, this would be the time to do so. Or you can also feel free to come up to the stage if you would prefer to talk to them that way. I'd now like to thank our panelists for taking the time out of their busy days to come talk today. So if you haven't filled out your Learning Passport survey and in your booklet, this would be the time to do so. There will be stamping at the top of the stairs as well as right over there. So yeah, thank you all for coming to the Tourism and Hospitality Management panel.